Good morning, class. My name is Nanette Ramirez, and I'll be your moderator for this morning's session. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, and it is not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of His eternal purpose, pattern, and plan, operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various parts of the world. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lords many and Gods many, but we now know that each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. That means Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for Himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by the letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings of the true and original name of our Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state He is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in His pure spirit state symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize Himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of Him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form, right within Himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being that is having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form could only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self same spirit manifested Himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there is only one name given until salvation, and we must know that name. The simple yet intelligent question that we should ask ourselves is, What was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop of Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. Yahweh instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. The pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. Our 10 primary constitutional objectives and aims of this institute are, first, to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Second, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called law of natures and the powers latent in man. Fourth, to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth, to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth, to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh, to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth, to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith, which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth, to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained, there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. Tenth, to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah, with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. This morning we'll have a prayer by Dr. Sean Hudgenwortel, and we'll have a selection of music after the prayer. And our scripture lesson is Matthew, the 11th chapter, and that'll be read by Dr. Eunice Reiser.
Good morning. Let us all bow our hearts and minds for a moment of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father Yahweh, we pray that you give us a better understanding of your divine purpose, pattern, and plan as we endeavor to learn something truthful about you. While we're here at the end of an age, knowing that you can take this thing out at any time, we pray that you prepare us for when you decide to get up off of your mercy seat so that we are found doing and we are found right. We pray that you allow us to prove everything according to your divine pattern. All these things and more in the name, the true name of your only begotten Son, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah.
Yeah. Good morning, class. Our scripture lesson will be taken from Matthew, the 11th chapter, page 14. And I'll be reading the Holy Name Version, Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name Version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trainum, Scripture Research Association Incorporated. Matthew, the 11th chapter, page 14. And it came to pass, when Yahshua had made an end of commanding his 12 disciples, he departed thence to teach and to preach in their cities. Now when John had heard in the prison the works of the Messiah, he sent two of his disciples, and said unto him, Art thou he that should come, or do we look for another? Yahshua answered and said unto him, Go and show John again those things which ye do hear and see. The blind receive their sight, and the lame walk. The lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear. The dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. And blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. And as they departed, Yahshua began to say unto the multitude concerning John, What went ye out into the wilderness to see? A reed shaken with the wind? But what went ye out for to see? A man clothed in soft raiment? Behold, they that wear soft clothing are in kings' houses. But what went ye out to see? A prophet? Yea, I say unto you, and more than a prophet. For this is he of whom it is written, Behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee. Verily I say unto you, among them that are born of women, there has not risen a greater than John the Baptist. Notwithstanding, he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. And from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven is constricted, and the forceful taken it by force. For all the prophets and the law prophesied unto John. And if ye will receive it, this is Elijah, which was to come. He that has an ear to hear, let him hear. But whereunto shall I liken this generation? It is like unto children sitting in the markets and calling unto their fellows and saying, We have piped unto you, and ye have not danced. We have mourned unto you, and ye have not lamented. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, He has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, Behold, a man, gluttonous and winebibber, a friend of publicans and sinners. But wisdom is justified of her children. Then began he to upbraid the cities wherein most of his mighty works were done, because they repented not. Woe unto thee, Chorazin! Woe unto thee, Bethsaida! For if the mighty works which were done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. But I say unto you, it shall be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon at the day of judgment than for you. And though Capernaum, which are exalted unto heaven, shall be brought down to Sheol. For if the mighty works which have been done in thee had been done in Sodom, it would have remained unto this day. But I say unto you, that it shall be more tolerable for the land of Sodom in the day of judgment than for thee. At that time Yahshua answered and said, I thank thee, O Father, sustainer of heaven and earth, because thou hast hid these things from the wise and prudent, and hast revealed them unto babes. Even so, Father, for so it seemeth good in thy sight. And turning to his disciples, he said, All things are delivered unto me of my Father, and no man knoweth the Son but the Father. Neither knoweth any man, the Father, save the Son, and he to whomsoever the Son will reveal him. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. I have read Matthew, the 11th chapter. Let us all say, hallelujah.
Good morning again, class. So this morning, this is our Sunday night, Sunday morning class. So for our first speaker, I like to call myself. I have something, you know, just to say. Let me grab my Bible. Okay. So I first like to start off saying, we must go back to Moses to learn anything of our Savior and our Father through our Savior. So with that, I like to start with, let's go ahead and start with John. I mean, we're not going to start Moses yet, but I'd like to just start with John, 3rd chapter, 16th verse.
John 3:16. For Yahweh so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Okay, so right here, the Christians, they love this verse. Yahweh or Lord, the Lord gave his Son, gave his little boy to save the world.
Right.
Because they're sinners. Well, we know that Yahweh gave his Son to fulfill the law and the prophets. Mm-hmm. That was Yahshua's main mission. Well, his mission was right. To fulfill. Mm-hmm. And now let's get, and Yahshua is his Son that he gave. So let's get John, the, is it 40 or 30? Let me see. I have it somewhere here. Let's get John 5 and let's start up maybe at 38.
John 5:38. Mm-hmm. And ye have not his word abiding in you, for whom he has sent him ye believe not. Ye search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me.
Okay, so let's stop there. So this is Yahshua. Now, Yahshua is saying this. He's telling the disciples of this. So go ahead and continue.
But ye will not come to me that ye might have life. I receive not honor from men, but I know you, that ye have not the love of Elohim in you. I am come in my Father's name, and ye receive me not. Let another come in his own name, him ye will receive. How can ye believe which receive honor one of another, and seek it not the honor that cometh from Elohim only? Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father. There is one that accuseth you, even Moses, in whom ye trust.
Okay, so right there, key name, Moses.
Also, the verse that I like for you to reread is verse number
43. I am come in my Father's name, and ye receive me not. Let another come in his own name, him ye will receive.
Okay, so now coming into this class, we learn what the true name is of the Messiah, is Yahshua. And we also know the true name of the Father, our Creator, is Yahweh.
Right.
So there's a similarity between those two names. Yah. Right. Yahshua means Yahweh is salvation. So now what's kind of hard to understand is how these Christians correlate or understand that Jesus is similar to Lord, to God, even Yahweh in that fact. So, I mean, there's no similarity whatsoever. Right. So with that said, I like to get Exodus. Let's go ahead and pick it up at the... we can go ahead and pick it up at the burning bush when...
Three and one?
Yeah, let's start okay. There. Yeah.
Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of Elohim, even to Horeb. And the angel of Yahweh appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed.
Okay, let's stop there. So Elohim appears to man through visions. And this is what's happening with Moses. He's having a vision because the bush is not being consumed. So let's go ahead and continue.
Okay. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush does not burn. And when Yahweh saw that he turned aside to see, Elohim called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here am I. And he said, draw not nigh hither. Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thy standest is holy ground.
Okay, let's stop there. Okay, so he's standing in holy ground. And how we know this is because we come to this school and we learn through these charts that, you know, they're pictured here, that we have three compartments. We have a court roundabout, we have a holy place, and a most holy place. Mm-hmm. So the way this chart is divided is the court roundabout or Egypt symbolizes the court roundabout.
Right.
The holy place or the wilderness of Sinai symbolizes the holy place. Mm-hmm. And Canaan's land symbolizes the most holy place. Right. And that's what I have to say about that. So let's continue.
Okay. Moreover, he said, I am the Elohim of thy fathers, and the Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon Elohim. And Yahweh said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. And I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them out of that land unto a good land and a large, unto a land flowing with milk and honey, unto the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites, the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel is come unto me, and I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptian oppressed them. Come now, therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. And Moses said unto Elohim, Who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh, and that I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt? And he said, Certainly I will be with thee, and this shall be a token unto you that I have sent thee. When thou hast brought forth the people out of Egypt, ye shall serve Elohim upon this mountain. And Moses said unto Elohim, Behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, The Elohim of your fathers has sent me unto you, and they shall say to me, What is his name? What shall I say unto them? And Elohim said unto Moses, Eya Asher Eya. And he said, Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I will be, has sent me unto you. And Elohim said, Moreover unto Moses, Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, Yahweh, the Elohim of your fathers, the Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob, has sent me unto you.
Okay. So let's go ahead and stop there. And I'd like to get the King James Version of that, sure, those verses, okay, just to show the comparison of the, you know, using the true name versus using titles.
Right.
You want me to go with?
Yeah, just the part where it says who should, you know, who should I say?
I'll say 14. Mm-hmm. And God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And he said, Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am have sent me unto you. And God said, Moreover unto Moses, Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, The Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has sent me unto you. This is my name forever, and this is my memorial unto all generations.
Okay, so coming to the school, we know that that's an error. Lord, God, they're not names, that's for sure.
Right.
And I mean, to me, it kind of makes it sound like, okay, did Lord God not understand what Moses was asking? He's asking for a name.
Yeah, right.
So, you know,
yeah,
we know now, you know, from coming to the school and this being pointed out to us and shown by the Holy Spirit that that is an error and that is not the true name. Mm-hmm. I'd like to kind of go back a little bit when he's okay. saying, I am the Elohim of your fathers, Abraham. Go ahead and pick that up. It's right within that verse.
Okay. Okay. Moreover, he said, yeah, because there's either we can go with 6 or 13.
And either one of them.
Yeah.
Yeah, either one.
Moreover, he said, I am the Elohim of thy fathers, the Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob.
Okay, so Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob are the fathers of the children of Israel. So the reason why he named them is because He gave them the covenant. He's the one that told them about the covenant he has with them. So he had a covenant with Israel through Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, which is Israel. So let's go ahead and go back, and this is how we know that. Let's get Genesis the. Let's see. And get Genesis the
No, actually, we can get Exodus 6 and 5 again. I just want the part where it says that he remembered his covenant, that Yahweh remembered his covenant.
Exodus 6 and 5?
Yes.
And I have also heard the groanings of the children of Israel, whom the Egyptians keep in bondage. And I have remembered my covenant. Wherefore, say unto the children of Israel, I am Yahweh, and I will bring you out from under the burden of the Egyptians. And I will release you out of their bondage, and I will redeem you with a stretched out arm and with great judgments.
Okay, there is a lot said there. But what I want to get to is he remembered his covenant. So it's already established. There's a covenant with Israel, mm-hmm. the children of Israel. So what that covenant is, the beginning of it, what it was established. Can we get when he establishes the covenant and he tells, I believe it might be Abraham, what he's going to do with his seed?
I think that's 12. I think it's 12 and 1.
Okay.
Now Yahweh has said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will show thee, and I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee, and in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed.
Okay, yeah, that's fine. So there's an established covenant. So he also says, which I didn't elaborate on either, in Exodus when Eunice was reading, that they are his people, the children of Israel. Mm-hmm. So with that said, I'm sorry I'm skipping around. I just want to, go kind of play by play, try the best way I know to understand why these Israelites, not why, but why the law was given to them, or who the law was given to. Because it wasn't given to us Gentiles, that's for sure. There's right. nowhere in the Bible you're going to see that Yahweh gave this law to Gentiles. So
right.
We can go to the part in Exodus where it says when they're at the mount and they agree to the terms. And this should show that it's the Israelites, the Jews, not the Gentiles, that are agreeing to this covenant.
Oh, that's the lamb. You're talking about the first to clean up?
Yes, yeah.
For 3 days. No, that's a plague. That's a plague. Okay. I'm not even there. Sorry.
Sorry, bear with us. I don't know the scriptures by heart. Is it the 19th?
Yeah, 19.
Yeah. Okay, how about 20? How about 20?
Okay.
20. Exodus, just start with 1.
20 and 1?
Mm-hmm.
And Elohim spake all these words, saying, I am Yahweh, thy Elohim, which hath brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no Elohim before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven idols, or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them. For I, Yahweh, thy Elohim, am a jealous Elohim, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. Thou shalt not take away the name of Yahweh, thy Elohim, to bring it to naught. For Yahweh will not hold him guiltless that taketh away his name to bring it to naught.
Okay. So right there, he's establishing the law of how he wants it to be. Let's skip down to, I want where it says that they said all.
Oh, that Yahweh said we would
command it. Yes.
Okay, being ready the third day is in 19. So I know there's a couple of places they say mm-hmm. that too. Let's go to, I know in 24, they say in 24 and 3. You want to try that one?
Yeah, go ahead.
And Moses came and told the people all the words of Yahweh and all the judgments. And all the people answered with one voice and said, all the words which Yahweh has said will we do.
Okay. So right there, you know, that's the children of Israel saying that they will do what Moses, what Yahweh told Moses to tell mm-hmm. them, the law, basically. So I'm going to go ahead and take my seat and call up the next speaker. I'm working with this. I'm working how to speak and deliver some kind of lecture or information that was shown to me. So okay. All that, hallelujah. Okay, so The next speaker I'd like to call will be Dr. Samuel Salas. Sorry about that, my apologies. Next speaker I'd like to call will be Dr. Sean Hudgenwortel.
That's with the Zoom.
Yes, already hooked up. Good morning. This is still morning. Yeah, we got a couple minutes left. I appreciate what the first speaker got into, mm-hmm. and I'm very happy to see the increase in all of the members that we have coming down here to the school. I know that we're not live streaming on YouTube today. We're having some technical difficulties with our computer, and there may come a point where the computer stops operating and we have to kind of chop this up. But the show must go on. The gospel must be preached. So we're here. And it is definitely an honor and a privilege to address the assembly of the body of Yahshua the Messiah and speak on anything that I've come to know and understand that has been shown to me as a result of this school, which was put together as a result of a divine vision and a divine revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931, where he claimed that Yahweh, our Heavenly Father, put him, raised him up to the third heaven and showed him a vision likened unto the vision that Moses seen in Mount Sinai, likened unto the vision that Moses seen at the burning bush that the previous speaker talked to, and likened unto the vision that John seen on the Isle of Patmos, a divine vision, a vision of things that were good. And when Dr. Kinley came to from that, from having that vision, he didn't understand exactly what it was that he had seen. So Yahweh took him back up again and gave him a revelation so that he could understand these things. So he had a divine vision and a divine revelation. And Yahweh asked him what he would do with that which he was shown. And he said, teach your people. And that's what we're endeavoring to do down here at this school, is teach Yahweh's people. The first aim of this school is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and how he actually exists. Mm-hmm. Not just some random deity that has no explanation of the things that he does. I see folks, they'll get some kind of benefit in their life. They'll get a new car and they'll say that's God's will. And then they'll have a tragedy. Somebody get hit by that car. They'll hit somebody with that car. They'll say, oh, that's God's will. And they won't have any understanding of, you know, what's going on. They don't realize that the creation, the things that we see, they point back to spirit. They're just saying it's God's will just to, you know, forget about it. Oh, it's God's will. We forget about it. We're going to sweep that under the rug. We're not going to talk about it anymore. We're just going to say it's God's will and move on. Because there's nothing I can do about that accident that just happened, you know. But you want to be happy and when you get the car. When you get the car, but you plagued when you got to deal with the consequences of running somebody over with the car. And now you're going to say, well, it's God's will, but you still got the question, why would God do that? Because there's consequences and actions, and everything operates according to the pattern. It's ascending and descending. Mm-hmm. So if you understand something about this pattern and you know what you're going through in your life, then you know how many steps away you are from perfection and how many steps away you are from destruction. Mm-hmm. And sometimes if you haven't had that revelation, if Yahweh hasn't given you that revelation, then you don't know where you are on that pattern. Yeah. Until you get a cue. Like the car accident. That's a death. You down here right now. Now expect to go back up. Things are going to have to get better. You might be inundated in the problems, that come after, immediately after that accident, that represents you being down here in this court roundabout. But once you go through that divided waters of the Red Sea, that inundation, there'll be an anointing here at the holy place. You're going to come up out of that. Everything goes according to the pattern, and that's what we want you to know. Mm-hmm. The scripture lesson today was really, I picked it because I've just been working with it a lot lately. Is that okay? All right. So the scripture lesson today, I've been working with part of what's going on with that a lot. And if we can just pick it up at 28 real quick. I know I use that a lot. I've been working with it a lot lately, but I want to get into it a little bit more as well. And I'll be right back. Just don't. Go ahead and read.
Matthew 11:28.
Mm-hmm.
Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest.
Mm-hmm.
Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls.
Now he says, come unto me, all ye that labor. When you labor, you're working. You're struggling and are heavy laden. You got a lot of things on your mind. You got a lot of things on your plate. The so-called world is on your shoulders, as it might be. You're heavy laden. There's a lot of problems you're struggling with. You need some relief. You know, you can't just work all day and all night, 24 hours a day, 365 days a year, and without having any rest. Even machine that man has constructed, at some point in time, it has to take some rest so you can change the oil in it, or, you know, add some fuels to it, or there's repairs that need to be made. Just like this tabernacle that we have out here, we want to refer to this tabernacle and everything. This tabernacle, they say, was weather beaten. As the sun beat down on it, the cloth and everything that made it up started decaying, and it had to be repaired. And when that cloud that rested on the top of Mount Sinai, when it moved off of the mercy seat of this tabernacle and moved around, they had to pack this thing up. And when packing this thing up, if you've ever moved, things get broken.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? And when you get up in the morning and you go to work and you get a job, and if you have a job that takes any kind of physical labor, even if it's just physically sitting at an office and looking at a computer screen all day, your neck is hurting. You have problems. If you type too much, you wind up with carpal tunnel.
Right.
Things start breaking down, just like this tabernacle. And he's saying, he's talking about a spiritual thing. Those are heavy laden and that are laboring to know something about Yahshua, to know something about his heavenly Father. He said, come unto me and I will give you rest. Mm-hmm. Read 29.
Take my yoke upon you and learn of me.
That's why we got a school, because Yahshua instructed those people that were seeking rest to take his yoke upon them and learn of him. Mm-hmm. Give me John 5:39 real quick and hold your spot here in Matthew.
John 5:39.
Mm-hmm.
Ye search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life.
Now he's talking to the scribes and the Pharisees here, and he's saying, ye search the scriptures. And those were the wise. Those were the learned ones. Those are the ones who know how to read back in the day.
Mm-hmm.
Are we good? Okay. So he's saying, ye search the scriptures.
Mm-hmm.
And we understand that at this time, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John had not been written. The Acts of the Apostles are none of that. The only thing that they had to refer to at that time was the law or the Pentateuch and the testimony, which the prophets, with the law being the first five books of the Bible and the prophets being the remaining 39, I believe. from, but overall, from Genesis to Malachi, that's what they had. That's the law. And ye search them, for in them ye think ye have eternal life. He's talking to them. Like, if I was Yahshua the Messiah and I'm talking to some people, he said, ye search the scriptures. You guys search right. the scriptures. For in them ye think ye have eternal life. And what?
Mm-hmm. And they are they which testify of me.
And they are they which testify of Yahshua.
Right.
That book was written about him. That was not, or those books, excuse me, that was not Joseph's and Mary's little boy walking around and doing, performing all of these miracles, setting up or instituting an example for you to follow.
Right.
For you to lead your life by. To be, to attain unto your own righteousness. What we are here to learn is of Yahshua. And when we learn, in order to learn something about Yahshua, we search the scriptures to learn of him.
Right.
Not to get our salvation in those scriptures, but to learn of Yahshua, who is our salvation.
Right.
Because the scriptures testify as a witness unto what he's doing.
Right.
And this is how this breaks down. Give me Revelations 12 and 7 or 8, whatever book you're reading. Did we get more space on there yet?
Okay.
Let me know if it runs out of time, and then I'll stop talking and we'll. Okay.
Revelations 12 and 8.
Okay.
Read. And there was war in heaven.
Now there was war in heaven. Now let's come over here. Now this is our ages and dispensations chart. And the creation abides within Yahweh or eternity. Now, it says or eternity because Yahweh is eternal. And this cloud symbolizes eternity. And the creation is entirely within this cloud on this chart. That is just a representation of the creation that we have. Now, in heaven, there were angels that were created. All right? This is in the first age of the creation, in the angelic creation, there was a war that took place. Now, in order for war to take place, there had to be peace before that war. Now, the war took place and what? Read.
And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon.
Now, Michael and his angels fought against the dragon.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Now, come on right here. According to the pattern of the tabernacle, in this most holy place, on the Ark of the Covenant, overshadowing the mercy seat, you've got Michael and Gabriel. Michael being a warrior angel, so obviously he's going to be the one who does some fighting, and Gabriel being a messenger angel. All right? Now, Michael is a righteous angel, and he's operating according to the will of Yahweh. And him and his angels are fighting against who?
And the dragon fought and his angels.
Now come on over here. You got the same thing on this Aya Asher Aya chart. You've got a tabernacle with the most holy place. You got Michael and Angel and Gabriel right here. And these are operating in righteousness. This tabernacle is operating in righteousness. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon. The dragon is over here. The father of lies. The mystery Babylon. Iniquity. And you've got the same tabernacle, but a perversion of those righteous principles. Mm-hmm. Now you got Michael and the righteous principles fighting against that deception of Lucifer in heaven. Okay? Mm-hmm. Read.
And prevailed not, neither was their place found in.
Now that old boy didn't prevail. He didn't prevail against Michael. And his place was neither no more found in heaven.
Right.
Now, he was cast out. We're about to read that. And when he was cast out, he couldn't get back into this most holy place. So he was on the veil, that second compartmental veil. He was placed on that second compartmental veil on this pattern. That's why you got the six. Because that second compartmental veil is the sixth step. No longer being able to get back into heaven anymore. Mm-hmm. Give me where he's the anointed cherub. I think it's in Isaiah. The anointed cherub. Ezekiel. Yeah, 28. Yeah. And the start, thou art the anointed cherub that covereth. Because we want to talk about, we want to. Point out where that old boy is at. We want to see him operating so we can know what's been in your way when you come into this school before you know something about Yahweh. So that you can get him out of the way so that Yahweh can show you something about his purpose.
Start 28:11.
Go ahead.
Moreover, the word of Yahweh came unto me, saying, mm-hmm. Son of man, take up a lamentation upon the king of Tyrus, mm-hmm. and say unto him, thus said Yahweh, thy sealest up the sum full of wisdom and perfect in beauty.
They sealest up the sum full of wisdom, perfect in beauty. You sealest up this. See, look, you got three sixes here. Six, six, six. You got six in heaven, you got six in the incorporeal, and then you got six on earth. You got three stages of that six. That mystery of iniquity is sealing up and hiding Yahweh. And just like you got over in the first chapter in John, the Word, in the beginning being the Word. And that word was the life of man. He was the light in the life of man. And that light shineth in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not, because it was sealed up. That's why Doc said, the founder of this school, he said, that mystery of iniquity, that devil, to Yahweh is an asset. Because he's operating according to the purpose of Yahweh. He hid himself from himself to reveal himself to himself. Mm-hmm. And that is if you believe the report. Go ahead and read.
Thou hast been in Eden, the garden of Elohim. Every precious stone was thy covering. The sardis, the topaz, mm-hmm. the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, and the jasper. The sapphire, the emerald, and the carbuncle and gold.
That boy was draped out. Just like that guy that was up there in New York, Brooklyn, just got ran up in, and they stole all the $1 million of jewelry off of him. Yeah. I mean, he was draped out looking good. Go ahead. We're going to leave that guy alone today.
The workmanship of thy tabrets and of thy pipes was prepared in thee.
Sounded beautiful. Very alluring. As it was said, he was the brightest angel in heaven. If he was the brightest angel, then he got the attention of all the angels, okay? Go ahead and read.
And of thy pipes was prepared in the day that thou was created.
Mm-hmm.
Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth.
That's what I wanted. Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth. Now, according to the pattern of the tabernacle, in order to be anointed, you got to make it past this court roundabout In a tabernacle, you got to get past the door right here. And at the door, there's the cup of holy anointing oil. That's the fourth step. The fifth step is the entire holy place, which contains the seven-branch candle lampstand, the table of shewbread, and the golden altar of incense. And in order to get in here, there has to be anointing that takes place. Now, on this second compartmental veil, there are angels embroidered on this veil. Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth on that sixth step. But you can't get back up here into the seventh. All right? Now, you look at this tabernacle, and you can see in the tabernacle on the chart here. But if you were actually boots on the ground, and you were standing right here, you wouldn't be able to see the holy place. You wouldn't be able to see the most holy place because there's a wall that goes all the way around this structure. And that's covering up all of that. That's what we're looking at when we come in here. We're looking at the court roundabout. Now, when you learn something of Yahshua, then he makes the intercession for you. He is the light that gets up into your most holy place so that you can understand the things that you can't see from out here.
Right.
That intelligence that you gain, mm-hmm. the wisdom, the knowledge, the love, beauty, justice, foundation, power, and strength. Anything that you can have of that, Yahshua said, I am the way to the Father. I am the truth about the Father, divine intelligence, divine wisdom, divine knowledge. You hear people all the time talk about what is love. It's even a song. What is love? Mm-hmm. You know, they don't know. When you have divine love, you know something about the sacrifice that goes along with loving somebody. A mother will die for her child so that it can live out of love. That child will grow and may pick up some bad behaviors. And that mother, that same mother, that when that child was a baby would die for that child, they might not like that behavior, but they'll suffer that child to try to teach that child and correct that child out of love. Right. They might not like it, but they love it and they sacrifice their time. And if you didn't love it, you just throw that baby up, take it down to the CS Children's Services Board or get on out of here. You ain't got nothing to do with you. You ain't acting right. That's not love. Love is a sacrifice. Love is a compromise. Beauty. Everywhere you go, beauty is defined something different. And all around the world, beauty is defined some kind of way. The people down in Jamaica, they love the big girls. The guys here in the United States, they like everybody to be fit with low fat, big breasts. And, you know, some people like them with... I ain't even going to get into that. So, let me stop. But it changes. It's something that changes. It's corruptible. It's morals change. They're temporary. But when you look at that physical person, and you define their physical characteristics as what you love, that's not really love. Because when that changes, mm-hmm. when they gain weight, when they start getting wrinkles, when they get weather beaten like this tabernacle out here, do you still care anymore? Or do you trade them in for somebody who looks good again? Just like that child. Mm-hmm. It's the same principle. The manifestation changes, but the principle always remains the same. And that's what we want you to understand about this tabernacle. You know what true love is when you see the sacrifice that is involved in that love. Now, keep on reading over there that where you were at in Ezekiel real yeah. quick.
Thou art the anointed.
We had to stop the recording. No, we don't need to start streaming. We couldn't get on. We've been having all kind of technical difficulties. So, are we recording again? But there's a timer going though. We're good to go?
Yeah, 5 hours.
All right. Again, apologies. We're having technical difficulties. We're probably going to have to mend the videos and make one. It's been a rough day, but the show must go on. Mm-hmm. Gospel must be preached, like we said before. Go ahead and pick it back up where we were at the 15th hour, of the anointed cherub that covereth, and go ahead and read.
Mm-hmm. Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth, and I have set thee so. Thou was upon the holy mountain.
Yahweh set him so, and he was upon the holy mountain. Read.
Thou was upon the holy mountain of Elohim. Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. Thou was perfect in thy way from the day that thou was created.
That he was perfect in his way in the day that he was created. And you got over here in the creative age, he was created in the angelic creation, and he was made perfect in his way. He's always been who he's been, and he's been covering up the purpose of Yahweh since he was created. And we're talking about there was a war in heaven, because as he was covering up the purpose of Yahweh, the purpose of Yahweh was revealed. And Michael and his angel said, oh, no, not you, not you, Satan, not you, the devil, not you, the dragon, not you, the serpent, you, the brightest angel, but you're a creature. You're not the creator. We're not going to go along with that. So Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought and prevailed not.
Right.
Now go ahead and back over there in Revelations and read where they didn't prevail anymore.
And prevailed not, neither was their place found anymore in heaven.
Neither was their place found anymore in heaven. Read.
And the great dragon was cast out.
Cast on down. Read.
That old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world.
Yeah, he deceiveth the whole world. And we know that a world is synonymous with an age. He deceiveth him, being the brightest angel in heaven. There wasn't nothing brighter than him. He deceived all of these creatures. All of the creatures. Not the creator. The creatures. He deceived the whole world. And he was cast out. Until, read.
He was cast out into the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And his angels was cast out with him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, or his demons. Yeah. Read.
And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven.
Now this is John on the Isle of Patmos, over here depicted on this chart. He's having a panoramic vision of Elohim to John in AD 96. This is John, and he said, I heard a loud voice in heaven. Read.
Now is come salvation.
Now is come salvation. Now is come salvation. The war started because now is come salvation. Give me, now hold that and give me John 17 and 3, please.
John 17 and 3.
And this is life eternal. Now you want salvation. Now to what effect? To what effect should that salvation be? That's a question. Do you want your salvation to be unto the Mega Millions? You want life eternal, right? Mm-hmm. You want to live forever. That's what everybody asks the genie when they rub the genie in all of the movies and whatnot. They want to live forever. They want to be immortal. Thanos and, you know, they want immortality. This is life eternal. Read.
That they might know that thou only art the true El.
You want to be saved from death. That's what your salvation is. You want life eternal. Your salvation is to be saved from death. Now, we just read back over there in Revelations, which was a vision that John was having on the Isle of Patmos. Now, we just read that now has come salvation. So now has come the ability to be saved from death. That ye might know, read.
That thou only art the true El and Yahshua the Messiah whom thou hast sent.
That thou art only the true El. And Yahshua the Messiah, his only begotten son that thou hast sent. Mm-hmm. Now, we just had read over there in the scripture lesson in Matthew 11 and 28, where Yahshua said to his disciples and the people that were following him, take all ye that are heavy, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take on my yoke and learn of me. Now, how do you know of somebody? If you learn of them.
Right.
And that's why we're down here at a school. Because what do you do at a school? You learn. You don't go around and puff yourself up and see who can dress the best at school. I mean, some people do, but they don't pass, do they? Some people go to school to be cool and have all of the shoes and the apparel and all the accessories. And they don't do very well in life when it comes to doing jobs. They need to be kept. They end up marrying in the money or for the looks, for that physical appearance that we're talking about that falls away. But when that substance of that husband who has the knowledge to bring the money in, or the wife that has the knowledge to bring the money in, falls off, then all of those riches and all of that stuff that they have from that relationship, it falls off as well. And now they down here looking all messed up. Oh, I threw my life away. Because I didn't do what I was supposed to do. I didn't learn. And we say here at this school in the moderation that everything, absolutely everything, operates according to the pattern of this tabernacle. And absolutely nothing escapes that pattern of the tabernacle. So it wouldn't be too far-fetched for your relationship to operate the same way as the tabernacle.
That's right.
It wouldn't be too far-fetched for your education from elementary up into high school and moving on into your career to operate the same way as the tabernacle. It can't operate any other way than the tabernacle. And if it did, then we would have shut this school down a long time ago, because that's what the founder said. If you can find anything and bring it down here and say that and prove to us that it operates any other way than this tabernacle pattern, then we'll shut this school down and come and follow you. Now, there's been people who came up here and they said that it doesn't operate according to the pattern, but they haven't been able to prove it.
Right.
You can sit up here and say it ain't so all day long, but you don't have any substance. You just gaslighting or being narcissistic or whatever. That's just that anointed cherub that's covering up the truth. The founder of this school said in the introduction of the book is the only way that you can come to any kind of revelation of this thing is your ability to accept the truth. If you can't accept the truth, then that anointed cherub that covereth is hiding Yahweh's purpose from you.
That's right.
We're down here to get life eternal. And that doesn't mean that this physical body is going to live on forever. You're going to die out of the flesh. But the spirit that is within you, that lights you, will live on if you're found in righteousness.
Right.
If you're found with your house cleaned up. When the master comes. Go back over to Matthew 11.
Mm-hmm.
And start at 11.
Verily I say unto you, Among them that are born of women, there hath not risen a greater than John the Baptist. Notwithstanding, he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he.
Now we talking about John the Baptist. And he was born of a woman, and there's none greater than him on the earth plane. Now Yahshua was not sinful flesh. Yahshua was made in the likeness of sinful flesh. Now, and when Yahshua came to John the Baptist and asked John to baptize him, John said, well, do you got any sins? Yahshua said, no. He said, well, if you don't got any sins, then I need to be baptized to you.
Right.
You see, because what we want to get across to you right here, that Yahshua the Messiah, he's saying right here that ain't nobody greater here on earth than John the Baptist. But see, what you got to realize is that this ain't Joseph and Mary's little boy.
Right.
This is Yahweh in a body. All right? That threefold nature that we talked about, the 666, you got Yahweh in pure spirit, which is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything, taking on shape and form in a super incorporeal thing that can be seen in divine vision and revelations as Yahweh Elohim. That's the second state of Yahweh, representing most holy place here, and court roundabout down here. But these three are one.
Right.
Okay? This is what we need you to know. Now, John the Baptist, being that there's not been anyone risen greater than John, notwithstanding that he is the least in the kingdom of heaven. Because if you're looking at John the Baptist, you down here. If you're looking at that man, you down here. So he'd be the least in the kingdom, in the kingdom of heaven. He down here. No man can come to the Father except he go through the Son, which is Yahshua. That's consistent with what's written in the book. Do we need to get it? No man can come to the Father. What is that? 17 and 3? Is that no. That's 14. Wait a minute. No man come unto the Father. Let's just go ahead and get it. What did you say? John 14, 6. Yeah. So I thought it was in 14.
Oh. John 14 and 6. Yahshua said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me.
No man cometh unto the Father but by me. See, this here is that lamb slain from the foundation of the world, being made manifest in the likeness of sinful flesh, manifest in a physical body. Now, we read over in Revelations where there was a war in heaven and Michael and his angels fought and Satan and his angels fought and Satan and his angels prevailed not and they were cast into the earth. And we got this. And what we need to understand all along, you need to keep in mind these things that we have. These charts are here for a reason. They're helped to explain these scriptures. We got Romans 1, 19 and 20. Go ahead and read it real quick and I'll explain what I'm about to say.
Because that which may be known of Yahweh.
Now you're going to learn something of Yahshua to go to the Father. Now if you got to know something about Yahweh, you got to learn it from Yahshua, but you got to realize that Yahshua is Yahweh in a body, and that which may be known of Yahweh
is manifested in them.
Read.
For Yahweh has showed it unto them.
Yahweh showed it unto them. Read.
For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen.
From the invisible things from the creation of the world are clearly seen by what?
Being understood by the things that are made.
Being understood, they're seen and understood by the things that are made. And on this chart that I explained, in the first age, you've got the creative age. And you got the angelic creation that comes first. And you got the physical creation that comes after. Now, in the realm of eternity, it's all happening at the same time. Soak that in and meditate on that a little bit. But what you see right here, you got the angelic creation and the physical creation in a dotted line in between because they are operating together. That's what I just said. Mm-hmm. So you got the war in heaven. And what it, where is it said? As in heaven, as it is on earth. I don't even know. We ain't going to get that. I don't got time for that. But you got that war. And Satan deceiving the whole world in heaven. Same thing is happening on earth. The manifestation is going to take place right here on earth as well. So when this creation came into place, and we can know something about how the realm of so-called time comes in as a result of the divine vision and revelation that was given to Moses. After the children of Israel were led up out of the land of Egypt, there was a lot of things that took place before Moses was commissioned to go down into Egypt and bring his people out of the bondage of Pharaoh. But then one of the things that started this process of this vision taking place to Moses was the promise that was given to Abraham. That was around way before Moses was even on the scene, born or thought of. Like my mom told me, you know, there was all kind of things that she did before I was even a thought, a twinkle in her eye. You know, Moses wasn't even thought of at the time that the Abrahamic promise was given. But it was said to Abraham that through his seed, all of the families of the earth would be blessed. And if you follow his seed down into this bondage and out of this bondage, according to the pattern of the tabernacle, and you see that through his seed was given the vision, the divine vision, and the pattern of this tabernacle and the kingdom that they followed out here as a schoolmaster, so that you can know something of the divine makeup of our Heavenly Father and the unity of the Spirit, then you are blessed.
Right.
And you are family of the earth. Now, Adam was come down, and Adam was Yahweh in a body. He was not deceived. It's in the book. You got a book on that. You can look it up. We ain't going to get it right now. Adam was not deceived. Adam was not in the transgression. Eve was in the transgression.
Right.
She was the one that was deceived. That's what I said right over here when we was talking about that angel with the war with Michael and his angels fighting against the dragon and his angels. They prevailed not. Now has come salvation. The creation was deceived. The creation looked at that brightest angel in the sky. But the creator was not deceived at no time.
Right.
Just like here, Adam, he knew that in the day that he partook of the fruit, he would die. And Eve didn't. So when she did, he died willingly.
Mm-hmm.
He died for her. Yes. He willingly entered into the transgression. And when he did, he died in his consciousness. He went into a state of condemnation. Now give me Romans 8 and 1.
Romans 8 and 1. There is therefore now.
Now we just read over in Revelation. It said now is come salvation. Now we're reading over here in Romans. There is therefore now what?
No condemnation.
No condemnation. Adam and all men died. There's a book on that. You can find that too. And all men died in Adam.
and all men are made alive in Yahshua the Messiah. Read. Go ahead and read. Start again.
There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Yahshua the Messiah.
There is therefore now no condemnation to them that are in the truth. That have gone past that second compartmental divided veil. And the only way that they could get there is through Yahshua. Because Satan is no more ever going to find a place up here in heaven, in the most holy place. That's why he couldn't conquer Michael and his angels. He couldn't beat them. Because Michael are operating according to the righteous principles, and Satan is one step short of perfection. Mm-hmm. As far as Yahweh is concerned. So we got Adam, who willingly died for his bride. And he was told when he transgressed, when this law was transgressed, that he would have to work all the days of his life. By the sweat of his brow, he would have to till the ground. And the woman was told through childbearing she would be saved. And when you understand through childbearing, that woman, Mary, thank you. That woman, Mary, had to give birth to Yahshua. Being a virgin, she still had to travail in that pain of birth, of that childbearing, in order for the salvation of man to take place. The first speaker talked about Moses coming to this burning bush. Mm-hmm. And him turning aside and seeing the glory of Yahweh appear to him out of the midst of this bush. And at this time, Yahweh gave Moses his name. The first speaker talked about that in detail. There's some information mm-hmm. given right there. There's some knowledge given right there. There's some learning that takes place in the act of Yahweh Elohim giving Moses a name. Do you believe the report or not? Him that have an ear, let him hear. So you can learn something about Yahweh right here. We need the scriptures. John 5:17, is that what it is? Matthew 5:17. Think not that I come. Matthew 5:17. Give me that. I always get that mixed up. Every time.
Matthew 5:17. Mm-hmm. Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets.
Think not then this is the law where this is written about. He didn't come to destroy the law. Read.
Or the prophets.
Or the prophets. Read.
I am not come to destroy, mm-hmm. but to fulfill.
But to fulfill it. See, we got to know what's going on here. They didn't just write this down just to follow people around. And it was like keeping up with the Kardashians. Or something like that, you know. This was all written as according to Yahweh's purpose, according to the pattern that he's patterned from the beginning, so that you can know something of who he is and how he actually exists, which is the first aim of this school, is to know something about him, and that's life eternal, is to know Yahweh. And we've already defined life eternal. We've already defined salvation. So let's get into the meat and potatoes of this thing and learn something of them. So we got the name given right here. And then he's commissioned to go down here and lead the children of Israel out. And he's given. And then once the children of Israel are brought out, according to after 10 devastating plagues being poured out, and Pharaoh letting them go, and them crossing the divided waters of the Red Sea, and then them coming across the divided water Red Sea and being out here in the wilderness, and they come to the base of the Mount Sinai, and they told to prepare themselves because they're going to be given a law. Now, when he come up here in the first trip of Moses up onto the mount, when Moses goes up onto the mount, he's given the Ten Commandment law. They didn't have that law before Moses came up there. Now, when it was spoke down, the children of Israel said, all this that thou say we will do. That's a covenant. That's a marriage, right? I'm trying to get back down here to Yahshua the Messiah and the reason why he was here, why he came, why he had to do what he did, why he had to be born a virgin birth. It's all consistent. Now, they said that they was going to do it. Don't let Moses, please talk for us. Don't let Yahweh talk to us no more. You be the intercessors between us because he's loud and scary. We don't like that. All right, so he come back down and given this law. They said they was going to do it. He said, prepare yourself again. Give me 24, Exodus 24 and 1. It's the second trip on the mount. Read whenever you get there.
Exodus 24 and 1. Mm-hmm. And he said unto Moses, come up unto Yahweh, thou and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, mm-hmm. and 70 of the elders of Israel, mm-hmm. and worship ye afar off.
Yep, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, you're going to worship afar off. Moses is going to be up there too. Come up to Yahweh on this mount. Now go ahead, read.
And Moses alone shall come near Yahweh.
And Moses alone shall come near Yahweh.
But they shall not come nigh, neither shall the people go
They're
up
gonna
with them.
They're going to stay down here on the plateau of the mount. They're not going to go up, come near Yahweh. They're going to stay down here. This chart is static. It's not graphic. So there comes a time where they go up, and Moses is right here with Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and the 70 elders. But then him and his minister Yahshua, and we're going to read it, him and his minister Yahshua raise up from this plateau and go up into the top of the mount. Go ahead and read where you're at, though.
Oh, okay.
Read where you're at.
And Moses came and told the people all the words of Yahweh, and all the judgments, and all the people answered with one voice and said, all the words which Yahweh has said, will we do?
As a body, all the people answered with one voice. Just like when that law, that Ten Commandment law was given in the 20th chapter, it was rained down. They said, all this that thou say, will do. And before the second trip up here, all of the 70 elders, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and the rest of the Israelites that were brought up across the red divided waters of the Red Sea said, all this that thou sayest, we will do. These are covenants that they're saying. They're making a promise. That's a covenant. When you promise to do something, this is what you're going to do. Your word is bond. You're bound to that. Now, read. No. Now, skip down to where
Moses
8.
Mm-hmm. And Moses took the blood and sprinkled it on the people and said, behold, the blood of the covenant which Yahweh has made with you.
There's the covenant. The blood of the covenant. You see, there's a covenant taking place there. Now, that's a marriage. It's likened unto a marriage. Read.
Concerning all these words, then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel.
So it looks like they doing what they said they was going to do at this point. Read.
And they saw the Elohim of Israel. And there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of a sapphire stone.
They all had a vision while they was out here at the plateau of the mount. And they saw the Elohim of Israel. And it as was under his feet as a paved work of a sapphire stone. Now, we know this was written way before satellites, rockets, and telescopes and things like that come into place for you to get up outside of the earth so you can look down and see that the earth looked like a paved work of sapphire stone.
Right.
But it does. And we know that now. And that Yahweh was standing with the earth beneath him. Yahweh Elohim, was standing with the earth beneath him. Now, they seen this. Read.
And as it were, the body of heaven in his clearness.
And as it were, the body of heaven in his clearness. It was clear as a point that they could understand what they were seeing. There was no mistaking what they were looking at. It was very clear. Better than 8K, whatever television that you got. Mm-hmm. They were having a vision, a divine vision.
Yep.
All right? Mm-hmm. Read.
And upon the noble of the children of Israel, he laid not his hand.
He had hands. Read.
Also, they saw Elohim and did eat and drink.
So he had feet. He had hands.
A body.
They ate and drank. They partook of sustenance. They got something out of that experience. Mm-hmm. Read.
And Yahweh said unto Moses, come up to me into the mount and be there, and I will give thee tables of stone and a law and commandments which I have written that thou may teach them.
Read.
And Moses rose up and his minister Joshua.
Now Moses rose up and his minister Joshua, and we already know, if you've been to this class, you know the first verse said Moses, or first, second verse said Moses alone shall go up there, but he go up with his minister Joshua. Well, the reality is Joshua is Yahweh. And that's what I'm trying to get across. The unity of the spirit. You've got Yahweh, pure spirit, Yahweh, super incorporeal, which was the vision that was being seen by the 70 elders, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and Yahshua, concrete in a physical body, mm-hmm. being Joshua, the son of Nun, but there wasn't no old man Nun. He was the son of Nun after the flesh, just like Yahshua was the son of Nun after the flesh.
Right.
Even though he was born through the womb of the Virgin Mary, that was not her son.
Right.
Mm-hmm. He was salvation as it was declared through childbirth. The world should be saved, or man should be saved. Salvation would come through childbirth, mm-hmm. through childbearing. Now, that's according to the scriptures. And if you understand this pattern, you can see. All right. Now, Moses went up. Him and his minister, Joshua. I'm almost out of time. 24. Oh, that's Genesis. I'm sorry. I'm still in Genesis. Exodus. Whew. All right. 16.
And the glory of Yahweh abode Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days, colon.
Now, the glory of Yahweh. Now, Moses and his ministry went, minister went up, and the glory of Yahweh abode upon Mount Sinai. Moses and Joshua up here, and Joshua, the glory of Yahweh, he transmuted into Yahweh Elohim, and the glory of Yahweh abode on Mount Sinai 6 days, colon. Now, we saw teaching in school that after a colon, there's supposed to be an explanation, but there is no explanation after this colon. If you continue to read, go ahead and just
read. And the seventh day, he called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud.
What happened during those 6 days? We understand that Genesis 1 and 1 happened during those 6 days. And then after you read the first chapter of Genesis, then you should come back to that colon, mm-hmm. and read, and the seventh day.
Right.
You get your explanation of the 6 days in Genesis 1 and 1. Moses had that written at the beginning of the book because it was about the beginning of the creation of the earth. These books of Moses aren't about Moses. If they were about Moses, then the Bible would start in Exodus. But there has to be an Exodus before there's a Genesis. Because Yahweh had to come out of his ontological state of perfection in order to create and take on shape and form. There has to be an exodus of pure spirit before there's a genesis of the creation going out. And Moses was up in that mount 40 days. And he was called out of the midst of that mount by his minister Joshua, saying there was wars or rumors of wars in that camp. Now, they had made a covenant. This is the point that I was trying to get to. The covenant that they made, all this that thou say that we're going to do, they done broke it just in the time that Moses was up here in the mount.
Yeah.
And they continually could not keep that law that was given to them. And none of them could keep that law. No, none of the Jews could keep that law. So, Yahweh being the husband, Israel being the bride, them not being able to keep the law, the bride making that covenant, the husband had to come in and fulfill the obligation of that law that was given to those Jews. Deuteronomy 6 and 26.
Righteousness.
Yeah.
Okay. Deuteronomy 6:25, and it shall be our righteousness if
this
we
is the Jews. It'll be their righteousness. Read.
If we observe to do all these commandments,
you got to put emphasis on that. All. If you observe to do all. Read.
These commandments before Yahweh, our Elohim.
It'll be your righteousness if you deserve to do all of these commandments. Mm-hmm. If you break one of those laws, you guilty of them all. And none of them could do it. Sabbath day, for example. The scientific definition of work is what? Force times 5 minutes. Force times motion or something like that. But I'm going to have to get that down. But when your heart is beating, when you're inspirating, when you're inspiring, you're working. Mm-hmm. And on the Sabbath day, these Jews, they was told not to do no work on that Sabbath day. But in reality, they were working. Their hearts were beating. Their lungs were breathing. They were walking around the inside of their homes. They were doing whatever it was inside of their homes, getting up to use the restroom if they had to or whatnot. There was work that was being done. They weren't working out in the field. They weren't working in the kingdom of this tabernacle, but they were working in their physical bodies. Now, Yahshua the Messiah, he came through fulfilling all the 613 statutes, judgments, and ordinances. And when he got up here on the cross down here in Golgotha, and before he expired that last breath, he said, "It is finished." And he went into the Sabbath at that time, and his body stopped working. And they picked him up and took him into Joseph's new tomb. And on that Sabbath, he did no work. He was fulfilling. That's what he was doing. He was taking this out of the way. He resurrected on the third day, rose up early in the morning with the sun, and he was seen among the among the people. He was seen out here. And he tarried with them for 40 days, being seen by the multitudes. That's the word that I was looking for. And he ascended on the 40th day. And that angel said, "What you crying for? He gonna come back in like manner." Because when he arose on that third phenomenal third day, he didn't arise a fleshly man. He arose a quickening spirit.
Right.
And he was seen in a vision by all those that seen him. Now, he ascended into heaven, and then he came back on Pentecost, Penta being in 550, and he poured out his Holy Spirit on them who knew about him already. Them 11 that he walked around with, and they seen all of the miracles, and they seen all of the fulfillment of the statutes, judgments, and ordinances of the law, and they believed the report. Not Judas. He hung himself. He wasn't there. They believed the report, and they got the Holy Spirit, and they went out to preach the gospel. And the Jews, Those ones that knew about it, the ones that believed what the disciples were preaching, they got the Holy Spirit. First, the Jews got it. You got over here. First, the Jews got that Holy Spirit, a Yahweh, poured out on Pentecost. And then 7 years later, in Cornelius' house in Caesarea, those Gentiles, the same gospel that was preached first to the Jews was preached to them. And they believed the report and they received the Holy Spirit as well. And there's so much more to this. It can't be broken down in one class. It can't be in 2 hours. You just can't get it. But the gospel has been preached if you believe the report and you understand according to the pattern. And if anything was got out of this by any of those angels, Yahweh, his people, Yahweh's people, then all praises be to Yahweh our Elohim through Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Hutchinwortel. So this will conclude our Sunday morning session. We meet here every Tuesday and Thursday from 7:30 to 9:30, and on Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Do we have any announcements?
Yeah, I just wanted to let everybody know, and I'll put it on the table. We have a sympathy card for Jerry Geller, Oceanside Branch. And I'll have it sitting out there so we can all sign it and send it to her.
Okay. All right. So with that, let us stand to be dismissed. I'll be reading the last two verses of Jude, the doxology. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say, hallelujah. Hallelujah.